Junior.
The song is called No Ordinary Worship.
This ain't no ordinary worship. You already check out the song. It's by a new artist, Kalante Gavins. And the song says, this ain't no ordinary worship. It's no ordinary song. The God I serve is no ordinary God. And there are some things that happen in life that require an out of ordinary kind of worship. When I think about Job and all that he experienced, Pastor Alvarez, it required a not so ordinary type of worship. It required him to go to a place in God where he had to really not deny himself and get out of his feelings and his flesh and really seek the presence of God. Holman defines worship as interrelationship between divine action and human response to self-revelation of a triune God. Worship is a human response to a divine God.
Yeah.
It's how we respond to who God is, not what God does.
Right.
Worship is how we respond to who he is, even if he does nothing else. Worship is the human response to what who he is and not what he does. And in the broad context of worship, worship is a lifestyle.
Uh-huh.
In the New Living Translation, it reads in Romans chapter 12, verse 1, and so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you.
Yeah.
Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship God.
Yeah.
In the broad context, worship becomes way of life. When people see you, they know who you are by the way you live it. Because everything you do, everything you say, how you treat people, how you carry yourself, speaks of the God that's inside of you. Your life becomes a form of worship. To make it more personal, your worship as a believer should be your response to the goodness and mercy that God gives and displays to us each and every day. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, my soul responds in worship.
Oh, yeah.
When I just think of how good he's been, Pastor Alvarez, and when I think of what he's done, Overseer Jackson, my soul responds in worship.
Oh, yeah.
Not because he's done anything, but just thinking of who he is.
Yeah.
I begin to give honor to who he is. I begin to reverence him. I begin to have a holy fear of who he is. A righteous God.
Yes.
We gather in the local churches on Sundays. Many services begin with what we call praise and worship. We praise and we worship. But if on the front end with your mouth, it will provoke a worship from the inside out.
Yes.
All right. See, praise flows from the lips. Yes. Worship flows from the heart.
Yes.
That's it. Praise flows from the lips, but worship flows from the heart. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying this. You have to create an atmosphere with your lips that promotes the presence of God. And as you begin to open your mouth and praise him, which means to speak well of him, talk about how good he is. God, I love you. God, you're an amazing God. Begin to speak well of him. Create an atmosphere that once you create the atmosphere with your lips, the Spirit of God within you begins to bear witness to it, and you begin to worship from your heart.
Right.
Once your lips begin to create an atmosphere, and you begin to declare who he is, your heart begins to worship who he is.
Yeah.
And it's no longer about showing his name. At this point, it's no longer what he does, but just who he is. Flows from the lips, but when you begin to worship him, worship flows from the heart. See, once you begin to create that atmosphere, you begin to open your mouth, it ignites and excites the spirit of God within you, and it begins to bear witness to who he is.
Right.
And that's when your praise takes you into worship.
Yes.
When you begin to open your mouth, begin to bless God with the begins to bear witness to that. And you can't contain it still. It's like fire shut up in your bones. You don't know what to do with it.
Yes.
See, when you begin to worship God, it can be just you at home by yourself. And it's something within you when you get, see, when I get to a place of worship, Pastor have a raise, I can't sit still because there's something inside me that has to move. I can't explain it. I can't contain it. If I can show it to you in a picture, you wouldn't be, it wouldn't really match the picture of what I think, how good he is.
Yeah.
Even when I didn't deserve it. See, my heart, the spirit of God within me begins to bear witness with so in the text, when Jesus says, a time will come when you will not care if you're in the mountains or if you're in Jerusalem to worship the Father. Because when worship hits, you don't care who's around.
Yeah.
All right.
When you begin to worship the living God, when you begin to create an atmosphere that promotes his presence, when you begin to create an atmosphere with the fruit of your lips, you don't care who's around because the Spirit of God within you begins to want to. You just can't explain it.
Yeah,
right. You can't explain it. Know who you worship. You see, when Jesus said, you don't know who you really worship, but we do.
Mm-hmm.
See, the Samaritans, they were told about Jesus Christ and worship. Some of them they received it, but all of them still worship idol gods. They were still ashamed of the face of their people. So that he said, you don't know who you're really worshiping, but we do. For salvation comes to the Jews. Jesus wasn't being uppity and throwing off at the woman, but he knows the history of the Samaritans. See, even still, we have to know who God is and not be ashamed to worship him in front of heathens. Not saying she was a heathen, but we can't diminish who our God is because everybody don't believe him like we do. Which leads to the question, do you fully know the God that you worship? Better yet, doesn't even know you. If worship is a human response to a divine God, ask yourself, am I responding and worshiping to who God is as God the Father, the Sovereign King, or is my worship a pleading for God to do something for me? Come on. If your worship is a human response to who he is, then is your worship really to the God who was a sovereign God? Or is your worship your plea for him to do something for you?
Right.
Truth be told, some of us don't get to it. It's a true worship until we get in a true bind.
Yeah.
That's right.
If it gets to the rock and the hard place, you're going to have no other name to call but Jesus. But I defy you that if you create a lifestyle of worship, a pattern of worship, you won't even realize between a rock and a hard place because your life is already modeled in worship. See, worship should be second nature. Praise should be second nature. It should be something that life pushes you into, but something that you push life out of. Because when you get into worship, you push your situations away. You put circumstances, see, nothing distracts you when you're in worship.
Yeah.
When you get in worship, life situations, I encourage you.
Yes, sir.
When the storm of life hits you, find a place of worship.
Yes, yes.
Get in his presence. Pursue his presence like never before and watch how it doesn't even matter anymore. That's where joy comes in. The joy of the Lord is my strength. He will give you joy that is unspeakable when you get into his presence.
Mm-hmm.
When you pursue his presence. When you worship him for who he is. When you begin to call on his name and you begin to give him honor, reverence to him. For being the sovereign God, the reigning King, Jehovah Jireh. when you get to his presence, the issues of life become minimal and obscure. When you make him bigger than your problems.
Yeah.
Come on. When you make him bigger than your problems.
Yeah.
When you make him your object of your worship.
Yeah.
When he becomes the object of your worship, then you can't. What be God, Jesus, my provider.
All right.
All my needs.
Yeah.
According to the glory by Christ Jesus.
Yeah.
See, when you focus on God. When you focus on, when you put him your object of worship, and you're not pleading for his magic. And that's demonic, by the way. You're not pleading for him to do things because you get to a place you just want God to do something. But no, don't try to dictate God around. Get in his presence.
Yeah. Right.
Get in his presence. Get in his presence. The time has come. For true worshipers, with the true worshipers, please stand up. True worshipers are not intimidated by the crowds, where they are, the environment in which they're in. True worshipers don't care who's around. True worshipers don't care if it's 2 people or 5,000 people. They're going to still worship the living God.
Yeah. Yeah.
The evidence of a true worshiper is that you can still worship God if he doesn't do it. The evidence of true worship is when you can still worship him if it didn't happen the way you thought it was going to happen.
Yeah.
The evidence of true worship is when your worship is still on the same level if he doesn't answer in the time you need him to answer.
All right. Mm-hmm.
See, when true worshipers gather together, it should be like a forest fire.
All right.
It's hard to put out and even harder to contain. When true worshipers begin to gather together, it should be like a forest fire. It's hard to put out and even harder to contain. Because as soon as you think the fire is going out over here, all of a sudden a smoke cloud begins to lift over here. There's a smoldering happening because somebody over here, Pastor Alvarez, is thinking about how
right.
And you want to get good seats up front and just watch. get close to each other. I dare you to get close enough to the fire of God and let him burn away everything in you that's not belong. See, when you worship God for real, you really push into his presence. He's going to expose something about yourself. When you really pursue his presence, he's rolling up your bosom for real about yourself. You didn't know this.
Yeah.
See, some of us get afraid of pursuing his presence because you're afraid of being exposed.
Right.
See, some of us get afraid of pursuing his presence in worship because you're afraid of being exposed. You may
Yeah.
My worship becomes real. When you begin to worship him, begin to see him as Jehovah Jireh. When you begin to worship him in truth, he becomes Jehovah Rapha. When you begin to worship him in truth, he becomes Jehovah Nissi. When you worship him in truth, become Jehovah Shalom. When you begin to worship him in truth, become Jehovah sending you. When you begin to worship God in truth, it don't matter who sees you.
Yeah, right.
When you begin to worship God as the living Savior, the reigning King, the great I Am, the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, when you begin to worship him in truth, it kills your flesh.
Yeah.
It kills your flesh. You've been 20, 30 minutes you've been past, and you're still basking in his glory.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. See, we don't want to wait for the glory to rest in the house. We don't want to wait till the Holy Ghost came and shattered him. Just shattered him. You ever had somebody sit on you? You ever had somebody sit on you? It confines you. You can't move until they move. Let the Holy Ghost sit on you.
Yeah.
Let the Holy Ghost hold you down until your flesh dies. Let the Holy Ghost rest upon you until your own ideals die. Let the Holy Ghost rest upon you until God can really have his way in your life. Say, Holy Ghost, sit on me. Say, Holy Ghost, sit on me. Don't be scared. Say, Holy Ghost, sit on me. Get in his presence. Pursue his presence. When the worshipers get together, first altar, you need to clean out your closet. If your home is not your first altar, see, this should be an extension of home. When I come to minister, whether it's here or at St. Joseph, the worship I begin at home extends to church.
Right.
It extends to church. It doesn't begin here. It extends to here. Where does worship begin? When does worship begin? Does it end when the pastor gives the benediction? Or does it become your lifestyle and leaves with you out the door?
All right.
What does worship look like? What does it look like in your life? When you begin to worship Him in spirit and in truth, nothing matters. Nothing matters. Nothing matters. He loves you. He wants you to pursue His presence.
Yes, Lord.
He's like a daddy,
yes, Lord,
waiting for a phone call from his child. Mm. I got everything you need. All you have to do is ask me for it. All you have to do is ask me for it.
That's right.
All you have to do is ask me for it. Everything you need can be found in God.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Let your worship be for real.
Yes, Lord.
Let your worship be a way of life.
Mm-hmm.
Let your worship be an extension of your relationship with God.
Amen.
Let's worship Him in spirit and in truth.
Mm-hmm.
Not for show. Not for recognition. Not to be seen. But because He's reigning King.
Yes.
If He does nothing else, He